Well, hello there, amazing and wonderful nerdy geeky people of YouTube. So, we are going to talk about PCs versus VMs when people are testing out software and distributions, or they are looking at distributions for the first time and stuff like that. So, I just made a really, really amazing, highly detailed picture here with a VM and a PC that took me like 200 hours to make, so at least give me a thumbs up for that. So basically what we have here, this is a PC, like the bare minimum what goes into a PC, and this is like a virtual machine. What a virtual machine is doing is it's emulating a CPU, RAM, hard drives, graphic cards and stuff like that. So it's kind of like, if I make a virtual machine with 4 cores, 4 gig of RAM, and you make a virtual machine in VirtualBox with 4 cores and 4 gigabytes of RAM, they are identical. They are the same. My PC is not the same as your PC. We can have the same hardware. But depending on when, let's say, your graphic card was made, we could buy it from the same vendor, the same name and stuff like that. You could potentially have firmware that's more updated than mine or not, or older than mine, which goes in and also goes into the fact of performances and also capability issues. We may not have the same motherboard. We could have the same motherboard. Are we using the same BIOS version and so on? You get what I'm saying here. That's why VMs in a lot of instances are used a lot, both because they're cheaper than a real computer and they give the unified experience when we're talking on servers and stuff like that. When we're going into distro reviews, distro lookats, software lookats and stuff like that, what are the benefits and the negatives by running in a VM versus a PC? I'm at the firm believer that I believe that VMs for distro looks and stuff like that are totally fine. If you just want to show off a distribution, let's say this is a VM, you guys can see it here. If you just want to show off a distribution, you want to show people how it functions, how it installs, what comes with it and stuff like that, no problem doing it in a VM, because it's not hardware dependent. Like how the installer works is not hardware dependent. How GNOME works is not depending on your hardware. How I'm using Kritza here, how this Kritza looks the same if I'm installing it on a virtual machine or on my physical box. The only thing that's different is the performances. That's the only difference, and that's where real hardware comes into it. So let's change color here again and give that this one here. So when we are talking about performances, well, then stuff like the motherboard and the CPU comes into play, the RAM. We need to call all of this just to make it fun. You know, the RAM here, or you know, the CPU, all of these things start to matter. So that's where performances comes in. You get what I'm saying here? But if you just want to show off, this is the latest GNOME, this is what technologies it has with it, this is what GNOME looks like in the latest GNOME, and this is how, you know, what software comes with it and stuff like that, there's no reason why you cannot do that in a VM. If you want to test how fast is the new Ubuntu or the new GNOME or the new XFCE compared to other versions, you need a PC. Okay, I hope you guys are following me here. So a lot of people say, oh, I want to see my distribution viewed on a real PC. You know, because then I know it will work. Or it's more likely to work. And that's why I say no. I have a PC. You have a PC. The chances are we are not using the same component. So just because, let's say, again, we take Ubuntu. Ubuntu boots up on my PC will not necessarily means it would boot up on your PC. You may have another motherboard. We may have the same motherboard, but different BIOS versions. You may have the same motherboard, but different CPUs. That goes into a lot of small, minute variables when you're using a PC to make sure that a distribution runs the same. The same with if we are taking performances. Like, I get this benchmark on my computer. You may get another one. But you're saying we are using almost the same hardware. Yeah, but my CPU may be overclocked. I may have a newer CPU. Maybe there's a revision to the CPU I have or stuff like that. Maybe my RAM speed is not the same what you call it, from the same company as yours, so I may get a couple of extra megahertz out of my RAM and stuff like that. That's where all of this comes in. You could have the same amount of RAM as I have, but you may not have from the same vendor. So you were looking at my specification, say, oh, I have 32 gig of RAM, I have this CPU, I have this motherboard, I can boot up. Because he can boot it up in his video. And then you come in and see, oh, I can't boot it up. And then it turns out that this specific, let's just say, Bob's RAM modules have a problem with Linux. They don't work under Linux. But because I have Joe's RAM modules, they work under Linux. So just because you see a guy booting up a Linux distribution on a real hardware, don't necessarily mean it will run on your hardware. Case in point, and this was under Windows. I was talking to a friend. They recommended me an AMD card. I bought AMD card. I bought that AMD card. And I had stability issues. I had problem with this to high hell and back. And I was like, dude, this shit don't work. And blah, 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 blah. And I was fucking angry with him. And he was like, I don't understand it. Mine works perfectly. So I started to Google. And a lot of people had problem with it. And then just out of, for the sake of, because I was frustrated, I was like, I never update BIOSes on graphic cards. You should never update BIOSes on graphic cards and motherboards unless it's necessary, because you could go in and mess things up. But I was like, you know what? I'm going to update the BIOS on the graphic card. So I updated the BIOS on the graphic card to a newer version. It just worked. No problems. No blue screens of death and stuff like that. So I asked my friend to check his BIOS version, and he had, I think it was one version older than mine. But the version that came with my graphic card was two or three versions older than the one I was using right now. And then I started to go on to, I think it was Gigabyte or MSI, I can't remember. I looked at their forums, and it turned out that the first batch of those graphic cards they sent out, they actually had to mail people that they should update their BIOS because they had problems. It was the same AMD, whatever number, it was the same number, you know, it's the same batch of graphic cards, the same graphic card processor, the same tin and nooks, and I will not go into detail, but it was the same components on all the graphic cards. The first batch they sold was just with an older version. Then they made batch 2 that got a newer version of their BIOS. You get what I'm saying here? So just because it works on mine, and I tell you, this runs perfectly on my system, it may not run on yours. We also go into what keyboard do you have, what mouse do you have, what monitor do you have. I have had distributions not working on one of my monitors correctly because the resolution was fucking crazy. It was before 1080p became a standard. I have had mouses that worked on some distribution that didn't work on other distribution, especially if you're talking wireless and stuff like that. The same with keyboards. If you get keyboards with fancy effects on them and stuff like that, they may work on some, they may not work on all. So because it works on one reviewer's or one distribute channel's system, don't necessarily means it will work on yours. And it's the same for Windows. That's why sometimes if you use Windows, they are upholding updates back. Actually, I have an update on my Windows machine that's held back because my specific system do not support it. And that's kind of the great thing about Windows when you think about it. Because they are taking telemetry from your computer, they can see that, oh, you have components in your PC that's not 100% bug fixed in our newest update. So therefore, we need more testing, and then you get the new update. So they try to only roll updates out when they are sure that your PC is 90% capable with it or compatible with it. You can force the update, but they are like, we don't automatically install it, or we don't prompt you to install it. That's the most important thing. And then when all the testing has been done and a lot of customers have said, yeah, it functions now, you get the update. Where Linux just update. They don't check if, oh, are you using Ryzen or AMD's process? Oh, you may have a problem. They don't give a fuck. They just send out the updates. So in some aspect, Windows are doing that better because they are probing each customer's computer and say, you're ready for the update, you're not ready for the update. And most likely why you're not ready for the update is that you're using older hardware or you're using not so common hardware. And I am using, compared to the standard right now, I'm using like the first gen Ryzen CPUs, and I think that's why they are holding my update back, because it's kind of like an old processor right now. But you get what I'm saying here. So all the people that are bitching and moaning about people, what you call it, that was definitely not what I want. That people that are bitching and moaning about, oh, you should review on real hardware and stuff like that, don't really necessarily say that it won on your hardware. For all the reasons I just mentioned, BIOS versions, firmware versions, when was your RAM module made? When was your, you know, motherboard made? Because there are revisions to motherboards also. You know, there's so much diversity in hardware that you need to have the exact replica down to like the firmware versions to make sure 100% it will run on your hardware. Yes, you can say it gives me an idea, and most Linux distribution, if they run on one PC, they run on most PCs, unless you have like obscure hardware or you're using hardware from the 70s and stuff like that. I get that. But you don't really get any benefits out of it. And that's what they are saying a lot in the comment section, is that, oh, you're running in a VM, therefore I cannot be sure that it will work under my PC. Well, if I ran it on my PC, on my physical hardware, you will still not be sure, because we're not using the same hardware. I hope you guys are getting what I'm saying here. But yeah, like I'm saying, just because it works here, don't mean that it will work on physical hardware. Just because it works here, don't mean it will work on a virtual machines. So when people are showing you the latest and greatest that comes with the distribution, the software, the design, the installing process and stuff like that, well, not different if you're running on a VM or a PC. GNOME looks and works the same on a VM. I am using Cinnamon right now. If I set this up on my physical hardware, you could not tell the difference if I were on a Cinnamon, in a virtual machine, or on a hardware. I kind of want you guys to guess if I'm on real hardware or if I'm not on real hardware. It's really easy to tell, but I would see if you guys can guess this. You can't see the difference. So if the Tiger King is... I just rewatched that show, by the way. I'm reviewing the latest version of Ubuntu. If his thing is to just show you the new things, you know, the updated software and stuff like that, the new iCandy in GNOME and stuff like that, the new functions in GNOME, it don't matter if he's doing it in a VM or on a PC. Where it does matter is, okay, you have, like, you're rendering videos. You want to know how much faster is the new Ubuntu to render videos for you. Yes, go on. Then you need a PC. But I hope you can kind of see my idea here, or what I'm saying here, is that to review on real hardware or not real hardware, the only way that it benefits you as a viewer is that if you have the same hardware, the same versions in the BIOS and firmware versions and stuff like that, or close to the same, and if you're interested in performance, stability and all of that, you could say to some extent, yes, stability, because you have more components here that can fail, where in a VM it's so controlled that they don't have, you know, bad memories or bad CPU and stuff like that. But then we are talking about it's a hardware thing where it's not a software thing. You get what I'm saying here? Because if it's not stable with your motherboard and stuff like that, it could be that you have a bad motherboard, or the driver support is not there yet, or you need to update the driver support for the motherboard. Depending on if the reviewer have your motherboard or not, he will not catch that. That's kind of also what I'm trying to say here, that just because you're running it on real hardware don't mean that you will catch all the bugs and all the problems with running Ubuntu on real hardware, because there are so many different distributions out there. There's so many different configurations of PCs out there. So it is really, really, really onto like on a personal preference way. I don't know what I'm saying right now. You know what I'm saying here. It's so individual. That's what I want to say. That if I review Ubuntu on my hardware, with my setup, with my two screens and all my peripherals plugged in, I have a USB sound card, which a lot of people don't have, and I have a lot of problem with USB sound cards under Linux, because Linux and sound don't work well. Depending on what day it is and how the weather is, it when I reboot my PC, it defaults to one or the other. You can't just say, I want to default to my onboard sound card. It may work for 2 days, it may work for a month, it may work for 30 minutes, and then you start up a program and it, oh, let me use your USB sound card. And I'm like, why is there no fucking sound coming out of foam or a game and stuff like that? Don't get me into Linux and sound. But you get what I'm saying here. So I could bitch and moan about that while reviewing Ubuntu, and you're like, I don't have that problem. Why is it saying that? And how many people will find that useful? How many of you out there have a USB mixer plugged into their computer that they are using, unless you're a content creator? Not a lot of people. So VMs are really, really good as a showcase to show you new features, how it works, how to work with it, and stuff like that. Hardware is really, really good at performance benchmarking and troubleshooting hardware. Like if you have specific hardware you want, like let's just say you have a capture card, do this work on the Linux, then you of course need a PC. You cannot do that in VM, but that is really, really specific, and it's also really, really specific to you. Why do distro reviewers prefer virtual machines? It's faster, it's more convenient, and it gives you a unified experience, meaning that if you boot up a VM, you get the same experience. And they can do 90% of the review of a distribution in a VM because it's the exact same thing as a PC. Like I said, am I running in a VM or a PC right now? Most of you can tell, but a lot of people that just, you know, want to learn about Linux and want to see what is Cinnamon about and what is Arch about, they can't tell. What you get by running on a PC is performances, and that's it. And distro reviewers or people that look at software and distros and stuff like that, their job is not to make sure that distribution runs on every fucking motherboard in the world, every RAM module in the world, every CPU in the world, every graphic card in the world, and that every, you know, keyboard in the world works, because then they will never be done with a review. They're, what a distro reviewer is, they're kind of a salesman. They're salesperson. They are not an advocate, but to some extent they are, even if they are talking negative about distribution. Their job is kind of the same job as a car review guy, you know, a guy that reviews cars for magazines or in the TV. They are not there to make sure that the combustion engine works as it should do. They are there to relay information in an entertaining, easy digestible manner to you guys, so you can be better educated if you should run this distribution or buy this car. All of the other stuff is down to the engineers and stuff like that. And if you're interested in that, yes, of course you want to see people that benchmark distributions. There's people like Ichi, for example. He benchmark distributions against each other. Most people just don't like that, and it's evidence of his view account. If you take his distro deals, that's basically him looking at distributions and benchmarking them with each other, and then you look at DistroTube or Chris Titus Tech that run them in a VM and talking about the new features in a distribution, they get way more views than he does. So apparently the market is not for this. The market is, people just want to say what's new, what does it do, and all of that. And then if they get problem running it on their PC, they go to the forums, as they should, or they ask a friend, as they should, or they swing a dead cat over the PC 10 times in hope that it will work, as they maybe not should do. That's kind of gross. But you kind of get my idea here. So I will prefer if you guys will stop having this PC versus VM debate when we are looking at distro reviews, software reviews, and stuff like that, because in the end, you cannot be sure that because it works on mine, it works on yours. And the only thing you gain is performances. And if the performance in a VM is good enough to do the task they need to do, then do it. Like I do packaging in the VM. I do compiling in a VM. No problem at all. I just give it 4 cores, 4 gig of RAM, and I do kernel compiling and shit like that. No problem at all. The only thing I'm missing out of is speed. It takes longer. But if you want to show you guys how to compile a kernel, I can do that just as well in a VM as I can do on a PC. it's just more convenient to do it in a VM because I can close it down. It don't interfere with my running system. I don't have to reboot to go into it and stuff like that. And why? And you're saying, oh, you should just reboot anyway. A lot of times, if I'm on Linux or Windows, I have videos up. I have emails I need to answer. I have, you know, I have work things I need to do while I'm doing these videos in between here. So I need to remember, you know, bookmarks and stuff like that and make sure that I remember where I was in the video or, oh, I have to remember to respond on this email and shit like that. And then I can reboot. But here I can just make this video, like record it for 30 minutes an hour, close the VM down, and then I can continue with my work, my, you know, edit. I'm starting to learn Blender again, go into Blender and mess with that and stuff like that without having to reboot my whole PC. So it's just way more convenient. Or let's just say I want to show you a new program. I don't have to make sure that, oh, do I have any nude pictures of myself on my PC or desktop, or do I have any like tax information or social security number laying around in a folder that I don't want you guys to see. I just boot up a VM, I show you guys a program, I shut down the VM. So much more easier from a privacy standpoint also. Anyway, I'm out of here. Please don't have this war VM versus PCs. They are only really necessary to benchmark performances and to some extent stability. But you need to run the fucking distribution for a month before you get a good idea of stability. Most distro reviewers are there to show you new features. They are not there to troubleshoot each PC in the world. They're just there to say, this is new, this is good, this is what I don't like. That's what they're there for. So you get a rough idea of, would I like this distribution or would I not like this distribution? Would I like this software or would I not like this software? Because they cannot test the software on your PC. Therefore, there's no guarantee it will work on your PC. I'm out of here. See you all later. Bye-bye.